Thurman's classic novel. What is Thurman's classic novel, The Black of the Berry? I want to play from it. And it is... Can you hear the music being played?
Nope. No, you have to hi, this is Craig. You'll have to click participants and then you'll see see a thing that you'll see something that says under more. I think you'll see under more, I think you'll see add sound. Do you see that?
No.
Or share sound? Let's see. I don't think I could do it from my end. You have to do it on yours. Let me try it.
One more. No.
Steve, you'll have to do it, I think. Do you see where it says share? Share options, share computer sound, something like that.
Options more.
It might be
share sound. Share sound. Oh, that's
there the you word. Go. That's it.
Can you hear? Is this what confusion? Were you able to hear that?
Yeah, that's good. That's good, Marcel. That's good.
Okay, excellent. So this is what I mean. Been feeling this way since I was 16. Came to my senses. You never liked this anyway. Fuck your friendship. I meant it. I'm African American. I'm African. I'm black as the moon. Heritage of a small village. Part of my residence. Came from the bottom of mankind. My hair is nappy. My dick is big. My nose is round and wide. You hate me, don't you? You hate my people. Your plan is to terminate my culture. You're fucking evil. I want you to recognize that I'm a proud monkey. You vandalized my perception, but can't take down from it. And this is more than confession. I mean, I might press the button just so you know my discretion. I'm guarding my feelings. I know that you feel it. Sabotage my community, making a killing. You made me a killer, emancipation of a real nigga.
This is an unusual song for Kendrick Lamar. It is unusually aggressive, but it is a sign of him moving towards direct political commentary. Lamar also offers commentary on other kinds of myth-making. He does not have Melvillian semen, but he is aware of who writes the narratives of Black America. His song King Kunta, for example, engages typical braggadocio with the way the narrative of Black America is written in American culture, as well as stories of his early life and upbringing. King Kunta specifically refers to Alex Haley's roots, but also sporadically refers to the autobiography of Malcolm X, as when Lamar discusses 20 million walking out the court building, an echo of the 20 million Black people from a speech by Malcolm X. The ability of Lowell to refer to American history through names and often references to classic works of literature is not as open to Lamar. In his work, he replaces these references with more recent ones and with an awareness of a hostile the narrative construction of American identity has proven to be for Black Americans. For another example is his soundtrack for the movie Black Panther, which references the same influences as the album To Pimp a Butterfly. But the album helped shape the narrative of the movie itself. It creates another additional myth. What's more, there's a different kind of myth making. These songs start to incorporate tales from life on the street. Suddenly we hear of the possibility Lamar may have shot someone. Different songs address the topic in different ways. A form of myth making that we know from Lowell, who toyed with the autobiographical, most famously into Speak of Woe That Is a Marriage, a poem that's often attributed by readers to Lowell, but as Lowell once admitted, Frank Bidart tells a story from the point of view of Thelma Schwartz's wife. It is, what I find interesting about the myth-making of Lamar is, and I cut it from the paper, is that his biographer discusses his childhood at length and does not come up with any of these stories. He only discusses in the context of the songs where they appear. And it is a sign of the sort of the unclarity of where, what truth, what's the autobiographical truth of the songs, and how his life is structured in the stories of his own childhood. The confessional element in Lamar's poetry is similar to the confessional element in Lowell's. It's about creating a truth, about telling a story about life in a community. It's about talking to them about them and yourself. The song I mentioned earlier, the maligned early single, is included in the album, but as a live version, incorporating the time of publication and the audience into the album as a form. And it is worth noting, I still have it here, that it ends. So this is a way to take up the contemporary conversation about the song, about his publication of the song, and put it onto the album in as a form. And the inverse somehow happens to the song All Right, which is a personal cut on the album talking about Kendrick Lamar, about painkillers. It ends with the spoken word poem about depression, resentment, personal conflicts. But as a single, Lamar presented the song with a video that emphasized other themes lower in the song, specifically police violence. This effect led to the song being chanted at Black Lives Matter rallies around the murder of Black citizens by the police. Wait, do we have this? So you can hear, can you hear? So that's so the audience would there's more videos of that. The audience would chant songs from that album, which is an externalization of the rhetorical politics of the song. Although I do not have time to get into this last album, damn, because I think I'm running short on time anyway. It reads as a continuation of the voice found on To Pimp a Butterfly. Lamar has become a poet who is both private and public, whose public confessions of personal pain and depression cannot be separated from his sense of political narrative and local history. And yet, like Lowell, Lamar has developed his own idiom, keeping himself always one step removed from direct action. Lamar's work builds on that of other rappers. Tupac in particular keeps recurring. But his stories of life and poverty, of getting fired, barely scraping by, struggling with addiction, connected to his sense of public narrative, of myth-making, make for a remarkable mixture. There are other rappers who touch on similar topics, but the composition of Lamar's work and the general broadness of his approach make him unique among his peers.
Thank you.
I think I'm done.
Thanks so much, Marcel. Really,
I'm sorry. I had to cut the paper quite severely in the past days, and so like it's a bit there are some discontinuities, and I hope it made sense anyway.
Yes, it did make sense, and I'm glad. Sorry, I couldn't help with that audio, but
no, it's
but Craig Svonkin, who just appears like in a godlike presence, comes in and fixes it, so it helps us fix. Okay, thanks very much, and we should be moving on now to Diedrich Oosterdijk, who's going to be talking about illustrating.
Robert. How did it go? I think it went well. Yeah, I improvised a bunch of times.
Yeah. Marcel, I think you're still aren't muted yet. Maybe you wanted to mute, or? Okay. I just noticed that it's recording. Who is recording this? It sort of stopped. Is that you, Steve?
No, I tried to and failed. And so I texted Craig Svonkin, and he came in like a godlike presence and did it. So I'll have to consult with him later about why I wasn't able to. Okay. But you are being recorded right now.
Great. Okay, I'm going to share a screen as well. I hope this is visible for everyone. And thank you so much, Steve, for organizing this. It's really wonderful to be with you and share this new research on illustrating Lowell. And I would really appreciate your comments. So you can save them up for later, but you can also put them in the chat if you want to, especially if you think you have interpretations of certain images I'm going to show that I might not have caught. I would love to hear that. So I'm going to talk about illustrating Lowell, and Lowell has a longstanding relationships with a number of illustrators. The most famous one was Francis Parker, and he made the iconic image that you see on the left for Life Studies, a corridor with a lion in front of it. His relationship spans 30 years of working together with Frank Parker, as I'll explain in a minute. But there was also another illustrator called Sidney Nolan, an Australian painter and visual artist, who illustrated nearly all of the volumes for Faber and Faber, so the British ones. Parker for the American ones, for Farrar, Straus, and Giroux, and then Robert Lowell's volumes for Faber and Faber were illustrated from the mid-60s onwards by Sidney Nolan, an Australian painter. Okay, yeah. So there are basically two ways of thinking about the way in which poets interact with visual artists. And it has a long history. It's ekphrasis and illustration, point one and point two. And ekphrasis dates back all the way to Greek antiquity. Think of the Shield of Achilles by Homer, for instance. And these are poems, the verbal representation of visual representation. So poems that are about objects of visual art. And Lowell wrote a lot of them. And you see a number of these on the screen. And what strikes many people is that they're mostly about European art and classic European art. He wrote a lot of poems about old masters, including Rembrandt or Titian, and maybe most famously Epilogue, the final poem that he published in Day by Day in his final volume about Johannes Vermeer. The reverse is also quite known, that you start out with a poem or a written text, and that an illustrator comes and illustrates the text. And Lowell actually had a long relationship with illustration as well, even though that hasn't gotten much attention as opposed to the ekphrastic poems. In his first volume, he used a woodcut by Gustav Wolff for Land of Unlikeness. But then that long relationship with Frank Parker started and spans 30 years from Lord Wherry's Castle in 1946 to Day by Day, making frontispieces and making the covers for all American volumes. And as I mentioned, Sidney Nolan started doing that from the mid 60s onwards for the Faber and Faber editions. And in addition to that, he also illustrated Near the Ocean from 1965, that should be, and The Voyage from 1968. There's also a third category, which I find harder to describe, and that's why I've given them the name visual art poems. And these include poems about visual artists, such as For Frank Parker. There are two odes about his old friend. Also Outlaws, A Goodbye, which is a poem that he has dedicated to Sidney Nolan, and a poem such as Misanthrope and Painter from Notebook, in which he talks about meeting a visual artist, a female abstract expressionist painter, doesn't mention her name. And Nolan also features in this poem as a kind of interlocutor. I'm gonna focus in this presentation then on illustration, and I'm gonna end with that poem, Outlaws, A Goodbye, which he wrote to Sidney Nolan, and try to understand what his relationship with visual artists say about his poetry. So this is that very iconic image that I mentioned before, the frontispiece and the cover page of Life Studies. And Diantha Parker, Frank Parker's daughter, I corresponded with her, and she told me lots of interesting details about how he made these. He had a small printing press at home, and he used scratchboard for this particular image, which means that you start with a black surface, and by scratching, you end up with the white patterns. And it's famous for presenting the first view of Life Studies, a long corridor that looks kind of ominous with a lion in front of it. And the lion has been interpreted in several ways. Some people think that it's connected to St. Mark's, the prep school that both Frank Parker and Robert Lowell attended. But there's also a connection with Life Studies itself. One of the poems is for George Santayana in part three of Life Studies. And he has these lines about George Santayana, who was a Catholic priest living in Rome at the time, which whom Lowell visited in the 1950s. He presents George Santayana a little bit like Saint Jerome, who is often presented as a scholar. So here you see in this quote, him with a magnifying glass and the galleys that he's having, and he has a lion, and Saint Jerome was always depicted with a lion. But it's quizzical. Why has he used that lion? And you start searching for lions in poems by Robert Lowell because of it. What's fascinating about that relationship with Frank Parker is that it developed throughout the years. And what started as mere illustration really becomes a kind of interpretation. From what I gathered, both from the letters and from Diantha Parker, is that Frank Parker got virtual carte blanche. He could devise any image, and Robert Lowell okayed it at the end. I was fascinated, for instance, with the dolphin that's been mentioned a couple of times already. Was reprinted, of course, after Saskia Hamilton's book. And he presented this strange figure, also using scratchboard with pen and ink markings, of a woman descending in a kind of vortex a kind of whirlpool. And the question then, of course, is this Caroline Blackwood, or is this Elizabeth Hardwick, or is it perhaps Lowell himself, who is losing himself in this period in his life after he moved to London, and when his marriage to his third wife, Caroline Blackwood, was disintegrating. A very fascinating image, I think, and the connection with Dolphin, the poems in Dolphins, hasn't really been established yet. Another aspect that I find really fascinating is the way in which internally the images also refer to each other. Looking at the dozen images that Frank Parker has created, you see connections, a lot of water imagery. And here, I think this is similar. You see a man on the left who seems to be gliding from a rock and descending in water, a little bit like that vortex or that pool that I showed you earlier. Oddly enough, Near the Ocean was published in 1965. And even though it has this cover image by Frank Parker, inside there are illustrations by Sidney Nolan, that Australian painter I mentioned before. And Sidney Nolan has a completely different style, as you can see from this image. This is one of about 21 images that Sidney Nolan did for Near the Ocean. And it's a pen and crayon drawing, and one of two for Waking Early Sunday Morning, the opening poem of Near the Ocean. And as you can see, or hopefully you can see this is a tree of life. And out of it are a man and a woman, drawn very simply, primitively, childishly almost. And they don't have hands or arms. And the tree seems to have a fork-like prongs that stick out. And the text that you can see down below is also on the next slide. but it strikes a really weird contrast with that opening image. And lots of the works that Parker made are kind of classically inspired. They look a lot like the woodcuts or the etchings of, say, someone like Rembrandt, and really fits with his love for the old masters. This is very modern, but also doesn't seem to fit with the earlier style. So these are the final lines of Robert Lowell's Waking Early Sunday Morning from Near the Ocean. And I'll read it, these last lines. Only man thinning out of his kind. I'll do that again. Only man thinning out his kind sounds through the Sabbath noon, the blind swipe of the pruner and his knife busy about the tree of life. Pity the planet, all joy gone from the sweet volcanic cone. Peace to our children when they fall in small war on the heels of small war, until the end of time to police the earth, a ghost orbiting forever lost in our monotonous sublime. This was in the mid-60s, and at this particular time, Lowell had withdrawn to Maine to live in the house with Hardwick and his young daughter. And he was sending this really pessimistic message about the end of the planet. References in this poem, as Steve actually wrote in his book on Lowell, Police the Earth, he got from Walter Lippmann, and the monotonous sublime may be a link to Baudelaire. Nolan and Lowell also teamed up in a book of illustrations of Baudelaire 2 years later. The really negative, dark atmosphere of what he was predicting. He also talks about Lyndon B. Johnson at the height of the Vietnam War, was giving him an almost apocalyptic sense, and was writing in a way that is also a little bit reminiscent of earlier times, as volumes such as Land of Unlikeness or Lord Wary's Castle, where he's also talking as a public poet in a way. Now, Sidney Nolan at this time, and he may not be known very much in Europe and in the United States at this time, but he's considered the principal poet, Australian poet of the 20th century. And he's mostly famous for 27 paintings that he made about Ned Kelly. Ned Kelly was a 19th century ambiguous hero. He was a bush ranger, a derelict, an outlaw who had killed police officers, but he was sticking it to the man. And he was famous for being an outsider and an outlaw. And Nolan painted these right after he had become a kind of outlaw, because he went AWOL during the Second World War. He deserted from the army and came in a sort of weird liminal position that is slightly similar to what Lowell went through during World War II. And his fascination, so Nolan's fascination for Kelly, I think, is a little bit similar to Lowell's fascination for Tsar Lepke in his famous poem, Memories of West Street and Lepke. Both are interested in the outsider, in the one who steps out of society, even a criminal, and perhaps also because they felt criminals themselves, because they had broken the law just as well during World War II. And of course, Lowell had to go to jail for a year and a day. So at the time that he was doing the illustrations, Nolan was doing the illustrations for Lowell's volume, Near the Ocean, Lowell also wrote a poem slightly afterwards dedicated to Sidney Nolan about Nat Kelly. And he used in that letter, and in that poem, a letter that Nat Kelly had written to a politician. And in blue, I've put that sentence there, that Lowell quotes, "Our blood spoiled the luster of the paint on the gatepost, while the outlaw reigns, your pockets swell, 'Tis Double Pay and Country Girls. So yeah, this is a good example of Kelly sticking it to the man and attacking politicians, attacking police officers. And even though Robert Lowell in this poem is saying goodbye, it's a valediction to the outlaw type, to the ambiguous hero. At the same time, I feel he's very attracted to this kind of masculine hero. And of course, we know that Robert Lowell is fascinated with masculine heroes, especially during his manic phases. So while he was doing these drawings for Lowell, Sidney Nolan also returned to the theme of Ned Kelly. And one of the most fascinating discoveries I've done recently is that the drawings that he made for about Kelly, and you can see Kelly presented in this weird visor head, as you also saw in those paintings, that he draws Lowell in exactly the same way. Here, Kelly is sent away after he's imprisoned, but he presents Lowell in a similar pose on a chariot. And this is the cover of Near the Ocean in Britain, so in the Faber and Faber, and it accompanies Vanity of Human Wishes, the poem that's also in Near the Ocean. I think the attraction of Nolan to Lowell is that he was also outside of society and was also a truthsayer at a particular time. Even though he perhaps was trying to find himself outside of society, commenting on American politics as Lowell was doing at the time. This research isn't finished yet, not by any, by a long shot, but I'm seeing more and more connections between the two. And I'm fascinated also by the way in which Lowell was connected to a modern artist. It was very, very different from the European artist that he wrote ekphrastic poems about. Nolan was also the person who drew Lowell for this famous image in Time magazine, presenting him as Caligula. That's of course where his nickname Cal comes from, or part of it, and made him famous as the public poet. But he was also criticized for that because of it. And I think Nolan is partly responsible for this image of him as a truthsayer, as a public poet, but also a controversial figure. I'll leave it at that, but I'd love to hear if you have any questions.
Thank you so much. Now we turn to Eunyoung Yi, who will talk to us about The O'Hara in New York, Crafted Poetic Persona and Public Intimacy.
Thank you. Let me share my screen with you. So bear with me a little, a few more seconds. Sure. Okay. I'll start. Scholarly discussion have focused on Frank O'Hara's personality and sexuality in relation to his political stance, proposing a concept proto-political in contrast to the ideological. Andrew Ross highlights O'Hara's campiness in his tone, style, and subject matters by analyzing his poem, The Day Lady Died. Ross refers to O'Hara's poem as proto-political in that, indeed, most of the cultural texts we encounter are proto-political. They express an imaginary relation to real conditions of oppression or resistance, a relation that is often difficult to read, not least because of its contradictions, but more generally because it is expressed in a symbolic form. Texts, in other words, speak more than they say, even where they seem to be about surface things. That is, the proto-political obscures the poet's stance, whether he purports to criticize or celebrate the culture of the mid-20th century urban city, where the canonical high art and the unorthodox counter-cultural art coexisted. He insists that the poet performs a survivalist strategy by staging campiness as a new sort of masculinity in the 1960s. Quote, it is a response to politically induced oppression, but at the same time, it is a response that accepts its current inability to act in an explicit political manner to combat oppression, unquote. In other words, Ross's reading of the poem challenges the poet's reputation as a poet of trivia that had long led to general understandings of O'Hara as an apolitical urban flaneur. Furthermore, Ross's approach backs up my identity-based reading of O'Hara as a gay male poet who obscures and almost ignores a certain political position and rejects explicit criticism, while opaque political reflections are nuanced nonetheless. In addition to the deliberate obscuring of his political stance, O'Hara wrote about New Yorkers besides himself as cultural producers, insiders, and active consumers, manifesting New York City as a place where people from diverse cultures and backgrounds confront, conflict, and intermingle. He posed the New York experience as central to identity formation after World War II. His poetry has contributed to the construction and dissemination of an image of New York City, its landscape, daily experience, and subjectivity, offering an intimate, accurate autobiographical portrait of himself. Early on Sunday, written on May 1st, 1961, exemplifies how O'Hara identifies his inner voice within the relationship with the city and its people. In this two stanza poem, O'Hara expresses subtle uneasiness that he finds himself in the Sunday morning. It's 8 in the morning, everyone has left. The New York Times had put itself to bed on Wednesday or Thursday and arrived this morning. I feel pale and read the difference between the Maasai and the Kikuyu, and Kipsen identifies the other Kipsen learns. Newfangledness in white time was not a virtue, was it? Or should I get up, go out into the polished sunlight and riot in Washington Square, withdrawn with the fog, if you like singing, what happened to the clavichord? At first glance, the poem suggests a calm and peaceful atmosphere, not only because the title evokes an image of a mundane Sunday morning, but also the first two lines, it is 8 in the morning, everyone has left, implies serene quietness of an empty apartment. This early part of the poem, however, conveys a subtle inquietude by exploring ironies that result from sequences of O'Hara's inactivity. He feels himself behind by spotting the New York Times, ironical to its title. The daily newspaper delivers dated news about the city since it was published 3 to 4 days ago. The newspaper features ethnic tribes, the Maasai and the Kikuyu. O'Hara is musing on newfangledness that he found from the tribes. Given that he focuses on the newness in the already dated newspaper, his reading of the newspaper doubles the irony and thus doubly insinuates his discomfort that he himself postpones action. While the tribes identify and learn the newfangledness, he neither identifies nor learns new things for procrastinating this morning. Furthermore, ironical enough, this procrastinating eye is hesitating to go out into the polished sunlight despite feeling pale this morning. O'Hara is thinking if he should get up and go to the riot in Washington Square. Here, the poem foregrounds where the poet's uneasy scruple came from, which is the Beatnik riot. The Beatnik riot happened on April 9th, 1961 in Washington Square Park in New York. Before the riot, musicians, mainly folk singers, as O'Hara hints in line 12, would have gathered and sung on Sundays for more than 10 years in Washington Square Park. However, the park's commissioner, Newbold Morris, chairman of the board of Lincoln Center and a former founder of City Center Theater and the New York City Opera, asserted in an internal memorandum that what I am against in these fellows that come from miles away to display the most terrible costumes, haircuts, etc., and who play bongo drums and other weird instruments, attracting a weird public. His condescending hostility against the folk singing events apparently shows a stark oppression between high and low art in his mind, high art that he had seen in Lincoln Center, City Center Theater, and the New York City Opera. So endorsed by Mayor Robert Wagner, Morris prescribed the gatherings. Despite the ban, the folk singers and their supporters assembled as they usually did. On April 9th, the New York Police Department expelled the people and arrested 10 civilians who protested the police evacuation order. Next day, newspapers such as the New York Times and the New York Mirror labeled conflict between the police and protesters as a riot. The front page headlines of the New York Times read, "Folk singers riot in Washington Square." The New York Mirror highlighted the event as 2,000 beatniks riot in village. Demonstrations for the right to sing freely was held for 6 weeks until Mayor Wagner lifted the ban. Given that O'Hara wrote the poem on May 1st, the poem is set in the middle of the protest against the ban. Contrary to the turbulent turmoil of the riot, the stillness in this early morning subtly stings O'Hara's conscience as an inert artist. While he thinks whether to go to the riot, his passivity culminates by attaching a condition: if you like singing. The decision whether to join the riot depends not on himself, but on his partner. He therefore maintains the inactive, passive stance towards the riot, insinuating non-participation after all. O'Hara's hesitation towards the riot comes from his frustration with the rejected newness that he observes in the counterculture. Having asked what happened to the clavichord in the last line of the first stanza, O'Hara protects a frustrated feeling about newfangledness, an attempt to pursue something objectionably different from what one is used to. That is, as the antique music instrument clavichord would have probably witnessed it since its popular use in the late Middle Ages, a number of new and objectionable attempts to break the norm, break the high and low hierarchy in art, have been thwarted as the folk song singers' meetings and performances just have been frustrated. On April 11th, the New York Times remarked in the editorial page that Morris treated the crisis with intelligence and restraint. Beginning the poem with such a newspaper, which would belittle the newfangledness and support the city authority, O'Hara implicitly intensifies his feeling of frustration and hesitation once again when everyone has left for the demonstration except himself. In the next line, next stanza, O'Hara abruptly imagines the clavichord in the park and keeps implicitly and momentarily inserting his thoughts of newfangledness by dropping his iconic "I do this, I do that" mode. With hot dogs, peanuts, and pigeons, where's the clavichord though it's raining? I'm not afraid for the string. They have their heads on across the street in the dirty window, leaning on elbows, without any pillows. How sad the Lower East Side is on Sunday morning in May, eating yellow eggs, eating St. Bridget's benediction, washing the world down with rye and Coca-Cola and the news. Joe stumbles home, pots and pans crash to the floor. Everyone's happy again. O'Hara throws all the relevant objects within a breath. Hot dogs, peanuts, pigeons, clavichord, rain, ugly pedestrians on the East 9th Street, etc. Readers see these juxtapositions of irrelevant elements evoking an unexpected yet intense feeling of sadness and depression. By adopting surrealist aesthetics, O'Hara achieves the emotion without having to illustrate a serious critique of the political context of New York City. As for this digressive rambling, Jerry Perloff asserts that the New York Times does not symbolize anything. It is simply the paper everyone in New York reads on Sunday morning. For O'Hara, the Lower East Side on Sunday morning is a sad and lonely place only because he himself is sad and lonely. However, it is unwise to limit the New York Times as one of the random objects without considering the political context surrounding the city and the poet's personal circumstances of its composition, because such an approach often induces critical reception that O'Hara's poetry is less ambitious and more fragmented. Seeing the poem within these contexts facilitates the new understanding of O'Hara's poetry, not only as personal record of daily events, but as cultural intervention that projects the poet's conscious voice and sensibility as a social being. In the poem, the speaker functions as a living interrogator by duplicating the typical comportment of an ordinary citizen. It is also noteworthy that the poet represents the process of his thoughts as it happens. Perloff points out that the moment of everyday life represented the way an unexpected external stimulus can suddenly break a mood is made so real we can see and feel it. He initially thinks of a certain topic and then the first thought fades away as his eyes and ears do not stop perceiving every item and event in his environment. It shows how his thoughts are wandering. His thoughts are interrupted by other objects and feelings that momentarily return to the initial topic, yet briskly shifts to somewhere else. In such a succession of discursive thoughts, the poet often hints at the initial topic by momentarily coming back to it. Particularly, line 21 exemplifies how the poet's thoughts wander about and return to what he initially contemplated. The poet's sadness comes to the fore in line 21, how sad the Lower East Side is on Sunday morning in May. By giving these specific details of time and place, he represents himself as one of the New York residents who are inevitably intertwined with the city event that rejected the unorthodox counterculture at this moment. It is sad because the poet knows that his neighborhood would wash down the news, the implicit latent and collective culture violence by routinely having breakfast on eggs, rice, and Coca-Cola, or just going to the Church of St. Bridget. In the last line, when Joe stumbles home, Joe is O'Hara's housemate and on and off lover, Joe LeSueur. The poet's musing on the beatnik riot that has been interrupted by a series of random thoughts finally holds. LeSueur's bustling entrance breaks the stillness of Monday morning and thus resolves the subtle uneasiness in O'Hara's mind. Calling himself a drunken queen, LeSueur recalls this moment when he came back home drunk. Quote, I remember Frank and Vincent laughing uproariously at my antics as they snuggled contentedly in bed, so at least they were happy, unquote. As LeSueur remembers, O'Hara seems to be happy at this moment. However, if one links the second, I'm in my office and the whole system just automatically cut it off. As LeSueur remembers, O'Hara seems to be happy at this moment. However, if one links the second line, everyone has slept, with the last line, everyone's happy again, a question may arise. Would it be a real happy ending? Like when he referred to everyone in line two, he did not count himself as everyone since he was at home. In the same sense, in the concluding line, when everyone's happy again, it's hardly to see that O'Hara counts himself as everyone, because until the last line, there has been no moment that he expresses a feeling of happiness. Therefore, he cannot return to the status of being happy again. As his neighborhood forgets about the first disbandment of beatnik gatherings while doing its Sunday routine, O'Hara distances himself by referring to everyone instead of we or I, finding himself forgetting the news and looking happy to others, at least to LeSueur. The final statement, everyone's happy again, plays as a makeshift, as a sort of staged happiness and feigned solace that helps compromise his anxiety of the rejected newfangledness. O'Hara demonstrates his awareness of the reality of the city life. Far from falling in, into being serious or despair, O'Hara shows an attitude of life just goes on no matter what, with the help of such cultivated happiness. As a member of the city, he represents a daily life with full of ironies, naturally sensing the turmoil of the city, but does not have a will to participate in the resistance, but to be complicit in the collective oblivion. This is it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay. Well, we have about, I want to thank all of the speakers for wonderful talks and also and stimulating talks and also for maintaining the time limits under trying circumstances. So kudos to you all. And I want to open the floor now to everybody. Anybody have comments, questions? Alternative interpretations or anything that they would like to share with our speakers and with all of us.
I see that Adam has raised his hand.
Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't, Adam, I don't even see you, let alone your hand. Adam, oh, there you are. Okay, sorry. Go ahead. And I think maybe it worked better rather than raising hand, and I have a lot of faces on my screen, just plunge in as if we were all together. Adam.
Sure, thanks. Thanks, everyone. It was a great panel and lots of fascinating talks. I just have a really kind of straightforward question, I think, for Marian, which I really, really loved this paper, and thanks so much for introducing me to the discussion between Kaiser and Wolf. I found it really fascinating. And just this is really kind of sort of ignorant question in a sense, but you had said at one point that Kaiser felt she had no female role models. And I'm not sure if you meant just specifically to where she was located, or like, is there any kind of indication of whether the previous generation of feminist or proto-feminist writers, Wolf or, you know, Ruth Kaiser or HD, were an influence to her? Or was she, yeah.
She mainly meant in the Pacific Northwest. She lived in Seattle at the time. But on the other hand, there weren't all that many women poets at the time that were taken seriously in the really still male-dominated literary circumstances in the literary world. And when I think of which poets did she love, well, that was, for instance, Louisa Bogan. And Elizabeth Bishop also, but they were more or less coevals rather, they weren't part of her circle. So her circle consisted of Theodore Retke, of Stanley Kunitz, of Wagoner, of James Wright, of Richard Hugo, so all those specific Northwest poets, and they certainly were not known as feminists. And when Karenin wrote her first part of her poem, Pro Femina, which she wrote in every decade, she wrote a piece of that poem that she is most famous for, and I should have it here, but her friends, because Wagoner and Wright and Retke were her great friends, they thought she shouldn't publish it because it was too feminist. And then it was somebody else who said, well, you know, go ahead and publish it anyway. But they didn't like that, that she was going that way. No. I hope this answers your question, but she felt alone. And so she wanted to make it clear to the next generation of women that they were lucky that they had each other and that they could help each other and support each other. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
It's sad that she ended up on the outs with her public over gender issues, and also that now Audrey Rich is losing some of her public because of her TERF identifications. I don't know if that is or not, but
yeah.
I wonder if Marion or anyone has any comments about that. Maybe Marion, you're the right person to ask. Would you have a comment about that?
Well, I'm not an Adrian Rich expert, but even in the Netherlands, we find that Adrian Rich is losing so shortly after also the biography came out because of her stance there. I find that difficult. I mean, we have to look at poets in the context of their times. And so I think people are too strict on Adrienne and should look at what Adrienne did as a feminist in her time. And of course, she did all kinds of things that we could fault her for. I'm not too sure that we should fault her for that stance. Look at poets and writers in the context of their times, I think. Perhaps too simple an answer, but that's what I think.
Okay, well, thanks. Yeah. That's a very good answer. And anyone else have a question or comment on any of the four? Frank.
Yeah, Mary and I were discussing a bit before the talk started, maybe we could come back to that I was mentioning Hardwick's really nasty comments about Kaiser that come up in the Dolphin Letters edition. And you mentioned, I know Hardwick. What would you, what is the sort of interplay between Hardwick and Kaiser? And also when you say, I know why this, one would expect that or something of the sort. So yeah. Could you say a few words about that?
Yeah, perhaps I was too quick and too simplistic in that, but Elizabeth Hardwick and Caroline Kaiser were two ladies who really stood up for themselves and knew themselves, and they didn't suffer fools gladly. But Elizabeth Hardwick and Caroline Kaiser didn't see eye to eye, perhaps because both were queen bees. Again, too simplistic, but you know, that is what my first reaction would be. They did not know each other very well, and I don't think, I may have one or two letters by Hardwick to Kaiser, but that's about all. But I can see, I mean, also Kaiser rubbed many people the wrong way, usually men, I should say, because as I said, she stood up for herself and she wasn't meek. And even in the 1950s, when she was supposed to be a housewife and take care of her husband and her children, she didn't do that at all. She was sexually liberated at a time when that was not not done, let's say. So she was really people judged her by all kinds of double standards, and perhaps Hardwick did too. But my comment was too quick, I should say. Should study some more. Yeah.
I think we have time for one more question. Does anyone have one, perhaps directed at Marcel Diedrich or Ungyan? Yeah, Bill. More.
Hi, I was struggling to unmute. My questions are both about the Rich and Kaiser. What about poets? I realize it's very true. There weren't women who were getting respect, but there, Eve Miriam and Rosalie Moore both won the Yale Series of Younger Poets in the mid-1940s. Gwendolyn Brooks won the Pulitzer Prize. I mean, there were, but these strike me as maybe more with Miriam and Brooks, more political poets perhaps than Kaiser was willing to be. There were a lot of women being published in magazines. If you look at a lot of the little magazines at the time, there was one coming out of LA that published a lot of women poets. So it's a more complex picture is what I'm sort of asking, or I'm wondering why Kaiser wasn't noticing those people. I do have a follow-up question about the Lowell, but maybe I'm just wondering, was Kaiser maybe just not reading widely enough?
No, not true at all. She was one of the best read people ever. And she was also the editor or the founding editor of Poetry Northwest. And she published quite some women in Poetry Northwest. But on the other hand, of course, you had the dial, et cetera, et cetera. But I think at that time, she was the only woman editor of a literary magazine. And you said the small magazines also published women. Well, Kenyon Review was not a small magazine, but a literary magazine. And it did publish women. But I think about only about 10% or 20%, I'm not quite sure anymore. But when I did my book on the Kenyon Review, I noticed that that Ransom and his successors paid not much attention to women writers. Yeah. Yeah. So I hope that is enough.
The Kenyon, that would be true, yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Also gay writers, I think.
Yeah, also, yeah.
Well, thank you. A follow-up, Steve, with the Lowell.
Sure.
I found the Lowell talk was really interesting, Diedrich. What I wanted to ask about was, do you sense any, how can I put it? It seemed as though that drawing by Sidney Nolan on for Waking Early had a touch of, as if it were a child's imitation of William Blake. Mm-hmm. It had a real Blake-like quality to me. I was wondering if there might be a tone or something, any connection there.
I'm not sure.
Was Nolan influenced in any way by Blake? Blake, of course, is the outsider artist, right, par excellence.
Yeah, yeah. No, I know that Nolan really liked illustrating books. So, and William Blake is, of course, famous for illustrating his own books. But I've read the biography, Nolan's biography, and Blake isn't mentioned. But definitely the childlike and very primitive style is really striking, and that's typical for him. But these drawings are even sparser than some of the paintings that he did that also have that primitive quality. He was really thinking about sort of creating a new style, but was more interested in sort of French artists, the modernist artists at the time, than English artists. And there was a whole post-colonial thing too. He wanted to be really different from England as part of a sort of Australian nationalism at the time as well.
Right, yes.
Okay. I want to give anyone who needs to go off to another session permission to leave, and thank you for being here. Great, thanks. Maybe we could continue though for another 5 minutes or so, since we're all gathered here, and I think they're probably more questions. One thing I would want to say about the Blake is that, you know, in psychotherapy, they say the things that matter are the things that are come up all the time, or the thing that never comes up. And I'm wondering what you were saying about his desire to suppress Englishness in Australia. It implies to me that maybe there was some kind of suppression or repression of an influence at work there. So, you know, I don't know where that goes, but just some another log thrown on the fire.
You know, he's very much interested, and he also lived in London for decades, and uh-huh. That's where he also met up with Lowell again later. He was knighted ultimately, Nolan, even though he was a deserter for the British Empire, yeah, during World War, yeah, II. And only after that fact it became public that he went AWOL. So he definitely wanted to be both an outsider and an insider. So he wanted all the British and English acclaim, and the Queen owned some of his art. And so being accepted by England meant a lot to him. But perhaps because of that, he didn't want to acknowledge English influences in his, yeah, in his work. So,
yeah, but so I mean, do you think Turner? I mean, you know, Turner is like the great figure. Do you think Turner, as well as Blake, is somewhere in the unspoken?
I think he wanted to be really unlike Turner in his, yeah, landscapes. And if you see his landscapes, for instance, on Australia, they're really flat and not dramatic at all. Yeah. Have, again, that sort of childlike quality. So I would almost say he's anti-Turner in a way.
Yeah, but that's a kind of influence too. I mean,
sure. Yeah.
Great. One thing that struck me is that all four papers, one way or another, presentations, one way or another, were about the public and the private, which is
so important to Lowell and to Plath and to the confessional project, it seems to me. And but that, you know, Kendrick Lamar and Frank O'Hara are usually not thought of in that tradition. But I think that maybe if we think of it as a larger cultural project that began to occur in a kind of unchaotic form after World War II, that there are these similarities. You know, we're so careful to talk about distinctions that the, you know, Kendrick Lamar is talking about gang life and Lowell is identifying himself with the nation in a kind of, so, you know, very self-confident way that he could speak for the nation and or part of the nation anyway. And so there are all these differences, but then in a larger way, the Beat and the New York School and the confessional school and hip hop and reality TV are kind of like different signs of something that's happening, as of a larger impulse in culture or something like that. So I'm wondering if either Ung Young or Marcel in particular would like to comment on that or what you think about that.
I think in a way for them, like, you know, Robert Lowell as well as Frank O'Hara, I think they, in their poetry, they try to bear some traces of documentary the truth what happened back then. So that's really important in a way. Like you said, Frank O'Hara is in the, like, as a genre or like category, he's in confessional poet. But in a way, like you said, if they are really closely interact with the with what happened there, I think Frank O'Hara also kind of fit into that genre in a way. Like, you know, one of you said it's his I forgot your name, Marcel, you said like Lamar and Lowell, they also writing composing in really autobiographical way, right? So depending on how we define the autobiographical, I think Frank O'Hara also kind of fit into that definition. You know, more or less in a way, I think they all have some documented truth in their text and or like textual performance.
I think the theories coming out of life writing now, and they talk about life narrative, but I've been thinking about all of these kinds of poems and musical lyrics as life lyric is a way to make sense of them, not as a binary opposition, but as supplementary movements within something in culture. Anyone else want to, thank you, Ung Young. Anybody else want to say anything about all of this? Bill?
Patrick, I was really fascinated by your bringing in those Ned Kelly paintings and comparing it with Lepke's, Lowell's fascination with Lepke. It does strike me that there's a lot to be sort of gleaned from the outlaw trope. I thought of, in a way, of Ed, that how much those paintings would probably fit an illustrated version of Ed Dorn's poem, you know, a long poem about sort of gunslinger, right? It seemed like that same, I think you could almost take those paintings and intersperse them with that text, and it would have very much the feel of Dorn's poem on that outlaw. And it brings to mind the first time, just so you know, from an American perspective, I heard of Ned Kelly first because of the film that was made back in 1969, 70, right? So before then, Kelly was what I had no idea who this person was, but certainly that brought the film brought Kelly to an American an awareness, and that might be taken note of in terms of the sequence of images.
I wasn't even aware of that movie. I know that there's a more recent movie on him. Oh.
Well, it was famous because Mick Jagger was the one who played Kelly. I mean, and I remember reading newspaper articles covering the shooting of the film. I mean, you know, the production of the film. It was a big deal because, you know, Jagger was going to go into films after performance. So that's why the film in particular caught young people's attention.
Right. That's hilarious. I didn't know that Mick Jagger as Ned Kelly.
I'm pretty sure that film actually came out. It wasn't.
Okay. I'll look it up. That sounds fascinating.
Yeah. Okay. Anyway, I really enjoyed seeing those drawings and everything.
I think it's also fascinating to think about Lowell and Nolan having sort of like a similar experience of World War II, that they were outside of the sort of regular masculinity. And even though they felt vindicated by the times and their positions, this resurfaced again during the Vietnam War. So, as I wrote elsewhere, when the Vietnam War broke out, lots of poets who had been soldiers during World War II started writing about their war experiences, that the Vietnam War really was like a catalyst for repressed memories from that war. So, Anthony Hecht, Howard Nemiroff all started writing poems about World War II when the Vietnam War was on the news. And yeah, I don't think it's a coincidence that that Nolan started painting or drawing Ned Kelly again during the Vietnam War, when all those, yeah, the war was constantly on television, of course. So that's a fascinating angle as well.
Yeah. Although when you showed those lines about Lowell, when he wrote small war after small war, in 65, Vietnam was still regarded as a small war. And I think that's one of the things that makes that line sort of so ironic, right? That, you know, from most people's point of view, 65, I mean, I was 18 years old at 65, and it never occurred to me that, oh, I might be shipped over there in a few years. It seemed like a very much sort of a distant police operation that surely they wouldn't let this thing get out of hand. They might go to the brink, but they wouldn't let it go, you know, expand to the degree that it did. And of course, we know what did happen. So I think that's a good
point. Yeah.
If I remember right, he wrote that poem during the period of escalation in summer of 1965, and so, you know, poet often has this kind of prophetic quality that I don't remember thinking it was going to
65, and exactly it was the summer that suddenly, right, you know, things, you know, small war after small war.
Well, and we've had some war after war too, the forever war, they know.
I think, you know, that Vietnam was the southern flank of the extended Asian war that began in Korea in the early 50s.
Uh-huh. I actually also have a question for Mariam, if I can. I'm curious, you mentioned that in that letter when Caroline Kaiser was marrying again, that Adrian Rich felt protective of her. And you mentioned that she's younger than Caroline Kaiser, right? Would you describe their relationship at that point as like sisterly, and that or how would you characterize it?
No, not sisterly. That's too close. So I was amazed when I found a letter by Adrian Rich saying that she felt protective towards Carolyn, because not many people felt protective towards Carolyn because it seemed that she could take care of herself very well. But after 20 years or something, Carolyn was in love, and she had met this John Woodbridge just 2 months before Adrienne wrote her that letter, and she said, I'm going to marry this man. And so she'd been single for 20 years and had many lovers, and Adrienne worried about Caroline, because what was she letting herself in for? So it was a rather unexpected letter, actually, because they respected each other. There is a correspondence. They sent each other, you know, letters once, twice, three times a year. They met each other at conferences, but they weren't close friends. They had shared a lover, though, a male lover. Caroline had been to Pakistan as poet in residence in 64, 65. And then she'd come back, and her Pakistani lover then came over to America, and He stayed in her basement in Washington, D.C., because she then was director for the literary program of the NEA. But after a few years, their relationship became troubled, and he then became involved with Adrienne Rich. So the ladies for a while weren't all too happy with each other, but that, you know, it was only a man so soon they respected each other as poets, but not really sisterly. I don't think Caroline was sisterly with Maxine Cumin perhaps, but not with Adrienne. Hope this answers your question.
Yeah, definitely, thanks.
Thank you.
Philip, I'm wondering if you have a question before we disperse.
Well, I've been having a kind of private chat with Diederik on the chat about the images. I thought that was amazing. A really fascinating way to look at Lowell and to look at those covers. And so I'll go back to where I pointed something out, but it seems that in the near the ocean, that the figure is kind of within the transport, is not sort of being transported on it, is sort of enmeshed with the wheels and isn't bound as well, and has the laurel wreaths. So there's something that he's a very different kind of take on that figure, and that the figure itself is kind of the transport, which I suppose the poet is, which I've said elsewhere there, that it kind of takes me back to Stevens, Transport to Summer. And the lion, I don't know, this might be too much of a stretch, but you know, Stevens's Lions in Sweden references illustrators and paintings, Apollinaire and also Dufy. And I just wonder, I don't know, it might be too much of a stretch, but that's what came to my mind. I was like, well, there's something going on here in the background.
Yeah, I really, really appreciate it. And there is something funny about that Lowell on the chariots, because he's slightly askew. And it's also, yeah, it's not a really flattering image, perhaps also because of Nolan's style, that looks so juvenile that that even the time cover, there's something faintly ironic, I think, about that image. And they were very, very good friends. And even though not much is known about their relationship, I think they mostly went to lunch when they were in London. And there are no letters, for instance, in Saskia Hamilton's collected letters. They met each other constantly. And the biographer calls Lowell Nolan's one of his soulmates. So I don't think he's ridiculing Lowell, but perhaps he's also a little amazed that his friend suddenly became this public spokesperson. And the most revered poets, but that's also ironic, since that was the time when Lowell's reputation started to shift and he became less reputable, and critics started to criticize also these lavish volumes that came out. So as reputation started to slip as a poet, even though his fame as a public figure started to rise. And I know that Steve has also written about this and about the reception of that. I'm curious if what Steve thought of that, those images, and also the time cover. Do you feel that's faintly ironic, or
I'm not sure I thought that about the time cover, but the others, yes. And that one that you're talking about, where is he on the horse or is he on the chariot or does he even know? And yeah, I did see that as ironic and iconoclastic. But another thing I was interested in is the similarity of Early on Sunday by O'Hara and Waking Early Sunday Morning and also Central Park, not quite Washington Square, but still in the same ballpark by Lowell. And Lowell comes later. So was he secretly reading Frank O'Hara or not so secretly reading Frank O'Hara? Or, you know, he tended to turn it down his nose at a bunch of people he really did respect on some level, which I think is true of Frank O'Hara too. So
he's also writing that to Ung Young that but my poem was also Waking Early Sunday Morning. And she also used the Frank O'Hara poem. And was also thinking about Wallace Stevens also has a poem called Sunday Morning. Right. So it seems to be a kind of trope of poets writing early Sunday morning.
Yeah, and I think there's some others too, maybe Lewis McNeese or someone like that. I can't remember now, but Sunday. maybe that kind of leisure of sleeping in, and not that Lowell didn't always sleep in, but you know, maybe especially on Sunday or something.
And also the religious element of like being the Sabbath day for Christians.
Yes.
And maybe even in sort of times after Christianity really took a hold, it's still a time of reflection. But with the O'Hara poem, it's a really different.
Yeah, no bells ringing in the background.
Exactly.
But there is that church, isn't there? So there we are. All right. Well, thank you all very much. It was just great. I loved it. And it was great to see you. And hope to see you again. And
see you on Sunday morning.
Is that? Tomorrow morning? Yeah, Sunday morning. Yeah, right. Okay. Thanks a lot. Great session.